Great. All right. Well, thanks so much, everyone. My name is Jeremy Gregory. I'm the Executive Director of the Concrete Sustainability Hub, and I'd like to welcome you to our monthly webinar series. And today we have a special guest who's a professor here at MIT who does some research that's related to some of what we do at the Hub. And so we thought it would be great to share it with you, and he's looking for feedback from everyone on some of our work, and it's a little bit different take on concrete sustainability. So with that, I'm going to hand it over to Admir and let him do the introduction and then share his work with us.
Wonderful.
And,
thank you.
Sorry. One last thing I wanted to mention. If anyone has questions and answers to minimize background noise, we've muted everyone. But in the upper right of your WebEx panel, there's a question and answer button. And you can click on that, and that's how you can answer or enter in questions, and we'll do a Q&A session at the end where we can ask Admir questions. So please use that chat box. All right, take it away, Admir. Thanks.
Thank you very much for this opportunity to share some of the very recent work we have been doing in my lab here at the MIT. It's inspired by antiquity, as the title says, and we are aiming to design materials that are more durable and allow us to build more sustainable buildings and infrastructure. So, I'm trying to move the slide, so let's see if this works. Here we go. So this is the outline of my presentation today, and I would like to share with you basically advances that recently we managed to achieve when it comes to multi-scale characterization of these complex materials. And this multi-scale is the key word that in the sense that we try really to go from a macroscopic down to the nanoscopic and molecular level, so several orders of magnitude. I will introduce you to this antiqua or antiquity-inspired materials, and then I will focus, I think, for this audience to the most exciting example, which is Roman concrete, with delivering some final remarks and maybe open a discussion with all of you. So research topics in my lab are basically around two main sources of inspiration. We use biology as one of inspiration in a sense that biology does build the really outstanding materials and these strategies, design strategies that are, you know, intrinsic to biological design, and therefore a long time to optimize these materials is the knowledge that we would like to reverse engineer in our new future materials. And a very similar concept is antiqua or antiquity-inspired materials, where instead of using, actually, I will tell you more about that in the next few minutes. Let me move quickly into the third topic that is very important in our lab, is to understand the interaction of these materials in the environment, and of course suggest durable and more sustainable construction materials. And of course, all this has to be you know, coordinated and connected with the advanced characterization tools. Why I say characterization? Because this is where my lab mainly focuses, and it's in a close contact with people that you know, work extensively on computational modeling. And I think these two approaches are really important to bring together when it comes to answering questions about complex processes that take place in these materials. So as I said, there is a wide range of characterization tools, and my lab is focusing on many of these listed here. And they, what really is the key in all this challenging characterization is to work across the scales. We are talking really about centimeter big samples that then are, you know, somehow hierarchically organized through different scales, going down really to nanoscale. And this is where I put most of the efforts. And here is an example of a platform, characterization platform, mainly based on Raman spectroscopy. Raman is a spectroscopic tool able to give us an information on molecular vibrations of molecules. So we are talking about molecular level information, and these vibrations are clear indication of molecular structure, composition, phases, and stuff like that. Once you put that spectroscopic information on the microscope, you can really get important structural features combined with that chemical information. So chemical imaging here, high resolution polarized 3D Raman imaging, or if combined with another microscopy tool that you can access, for example, nanoscale like atomic force microscopy, you can combine chemical information and nanoscale information, or if combined with this profilometry, you can basically access a large irregular samples, and I will show you an example here, and chemical image. Of course, in our lab, we are interested in mechanical properties, so there is a lot of work to combine in situ mechanical tests of these materials and all the above mentioned tools. So here is an example that really relates closely to cement community, and here are really fresh data, I must say, we've simply followed the hydration of ordinary Portland cement, but you see from day 0 to 5 days, and the colors in these images are different phases, namely calcium hydroxide, ettringite, gypsum, and so on. And these phases come from really clear, you see, spectral signatures in the bottom of this image that can clearly inform us on what is going on in this evolution, time evolution, in terms of chemical phases and hydration phases that occur. And here I just showed you, I just cropped the image of the day zero, and you see if I click here, this transforms and changes color based on these chemical phases that we observed at the fifth day of the reaction. So clear chemical information and spatial information, but most importantly, in a really kind of environment that is not affected by any sample preparation, so it reflects directly what is happening in a real sample. Okay. Another tool that we do have in the lab, and it's really exciting, is the fact that we could take a piece of concrete and put it under the microscope and obtain. Here I'm showing you an example, actually, of a wall painting, Roman wall painting, which is cool because these precious samples are really difficult to study because we don't want to destroy them through sample preparation. So if you put it under the microscope and collect first a profile and then following that profile Raman, you obtain images like this that are actually now three-dimensional. You see surface profiles that are reflecting our chemical components such as cinnabar, red pigment, with a characteristic peaks in the Raman spectrum. Carbon black, for example, is another pigment that we find on this wall painting, which has these two broad bands characteristic for carbon. Okay, third tool that is really exciting and I think will contribute strongly in this research is the combination of scanning electron microscopy and Raman confocal microscopy, and this is the instrument that we have here in the lab, which is basically a very sophisticated in the sense that combines all these two microscopies in one single instrument. And here just to show you the potential of these tools, I showed a piece of 3D printed concrete done by a visiting student from ETH. She basically took SEM images, and I guess you might be familiar with traditional scanning electron microscopy images. These are backscattered, images that reflect a little bit the composition, in the sense that the brighter the image is, the heavier elements are in this mixture, of course, on the cross-section, the sample. And this is, of course, confirmed then by using energy dispersive spectroscopy, in which basically we can plot the distribution of elements in this system. What is exciting about this instrument is that on top of these scanning electron microscopy images, we can choose areas and collect Raman images. And this colored image on the left bottom are different phases that we observe in this box here on the sample that was previously measured by scanning electron microscopy. And so we can clearly distinguish, for example, clinker in red and, for example, polymer that was added to this mixture with characteristic peaks. This blue spectrum here on the bottom right is evidence of the presence of this polymer all over this region here in blue. So you see the correlation between traditional tools that are informing us on cement composition with the chemical image based on chemical bonds and vibrations gives us, opens new opportunities to monitor, hydration phases of clinker, for example, in this other region here where each of these spectra are different phases of halite and belite. So, why we are doing all this, and this, I think, is the community that I don't need to explain much. We know the importance of cement and concrete and these numbers that you are probably much more familiar than I am are important in terms of the fact that 2050 we expect huge amount of concrete produced per capita, produced per capita per year. And so, of course, we know also the impact of this concrete in terms of carbon footprint, which is around a half a ton per ton of cement produced, which, of course, is an important parameter when it comes to building a sustainable future. So where now this carbon footprint comes from, if we look at the cement production, we have a limestone, clay, and sand collection and grinding. We have this hot stage, 1450 degrees C, which is contributing 50% to the CO2 footprint, and we do have a burning of fuels necessary to reach these temperatures that, of course, give us CO2, and grinding and transportation is only a small part of this pie. Okay, so this is what is actually problematic when it comes to our objectives to reduce, carbon footprint. And, of course, the current solutions that are available and are listed here are basically helping us to reduce 18%, reduce the carbon footprint, but this reduction goes only to accounts only for 18%. So the solution that we have here will lead to on 2050 to an increase of 18% instead of 50% the cut target that we have at 2050. So there are, in simple words, there are no solutions available to, you know, reduce this carbon footprint, and actually prediction is to basically have it increase instead of half it by 2050. All right, so how can we, you know, think, how could we reduce this? And, you know, there are many people working in this field. In my opinion, an important strategy that we should think of is to use less concrete and design structures that, you know, by design, structural design, have a less material needed, so with the same, you know, mechanical and structural performance. And the other part, and this is where I hope to make the biggest impact, is to extend the lifetime, life of the concrete structures. And of course, if we think about our buildings that last a little bit longer than currently we build, then we definitely will need less material in the future, and therefore make it more sustainable. So, of course, this is where ancient remains actually could help us, because ancient remains, you know, arrived to our times means that they do have some sort of resiliency to environmental conditions, and you know, they have some resiliency and some properties that could be worth looking into in terms of reverse engineering. So you see, this is basically a fruit of some you know, optimization through ancient technology and experience using available resources. Then this time component is the key for us to say, okay, there is something good in these ancient remains. Of course, there are many examples, and this is why we wrote this paper in recently. You can find it online in Angewandte Chemie. It's an interview that somehow looks into these ancient remains and try to suggest which of these could be valuable to look into and then reverse engineer, of course, through approaches that have to be across the scales. And here are a really clear example is Roman concrete, but there are other, for example, pigments. Egyptian blue is a really good example of how Egyptians were making really a strong resilient pigment by cooking sand, pieces of copper and natron at 875 degrees. Or Maya also developed a cool technology that basically introduces indigo molecule from a plant into a clay, Valigorskite, that basically this indigo interacts with the it enters into channels and grooves of the of this clay and is stabilized. This pigment, for example, is resisting to resistant to I don't know, nitric acid or alkali treatments, no problem, even in high temperature conditions. So you see, the point here is that there are materials that are there available for us to study and perhaps reverse engineer some of these properties in our new materials. So, of course, we know quite well cement paste and other important cement, and now the question is there an opportunity to use Roman concrete to transfer some of the knowledge from that ancient technology? All right, so what is the Roman concrete and Roman mortar? So Romans basically introduced this hydraulic reaction, namely volcanic ash and pozzolana in the mixture with lime, that allowed these materials to set underwater. And this setting underwater involves, you know, hydration processes that were really crucial in terms of developing Roman Empire because they were able to build the infrastructure, ports, and conquer basically entire Mediterranean country, sea, and all the countries around. So pozzolanic mortars have improved properties compared to, slate lime and lime mortars. As I said, we do induce this silica-based chemistry instead of just having the lime reacting with CO2 from the atmosphere. Interestingly, and this is basically a point that I want to stress because it's gonna, you will see, I will show an example on this, is where Romans, of course, had an issue to find volcanic ash, ash that of the quality that they would like to use was not always available, and what they did is to finely ground pottery and ceramics and introduce it into mortars. And by doing this, basically they did the same thing what the volcanic ash did to the mortar. So this is a kind of interesting, documented by Vitruvius in the architectura strategy to get available hydraulic mortars. When we talk about Roman mortar, however, the key problem here is the setting time. These materials, as designed in ancient time, take longer time to set and therefore are difficult to directly implement into current construction strategies. There is really an extensive work done by Marie Jackson and others in the field to understand clearly all the mineralogical aspects of processes that take place in these ancient mortars and concrete. Marie and others mainly focused on maritime concrete, which is really exciting when you think about constructing underwater and having a concrete resisting to 2,000 years of effects of the sea and all what comes with this weathering from the sea. They evidenced very interesting, minerals that are important when it comes to setting and making these materials resilient. Aluminum tobermoride is one of those that is just a crystalline part of cache calcium aluminum silicate hydrate, which is the binder, this gel that allows things to set. So there is a lot of things done on maritime concrete, and I think from my side it's really important to stress that there are some important aspects of these materials, and I will repeat this just to stress the point that we actually do not want, to reproduce exactly the technology of Romans, but we want to understand and reverse engineer some of these properties, and which these properties are really what of these properties are important for us. It's are definitely that the ancient Roman mortar and concrete has a lower production energy and lower carbon footprint, often using recycled materials and bricks. And it has that component, most important component, that is extremely durable and resilient to environmental conditions. So this is what I have been doing in my lab, and there are three main projects that we are focusing on. One is improving and defining characterization strategies of these complex ancient materials with Janil. And then we do try to use these new tools to understand durability of and resiliency of these materials through analyzing both the ancient samples and antiqua-inspired samples. And of course, this is exactly the work by Linda, where we systematically, produce materials that are now more, current, present, friendly, and try to reverse engineer only the aspects that we are interested in and introduce it into new mixes. So I will focus on the characterization part, and this is done with James Weaver from Harvard University, where we study samples from archaeological site near Rome, Privernum in Italy, and here is an example of what we can do. We can take this piece of mortar from a vault, and we do standard backscattered electron microscopy, but then we collect elements from this irregular, you see, untouched sample. So we important to say here that we do not process in any way this sample apart, extracting it, and then we basically are able to obtain this very powerful large area. So we are talking about 1 centimeter here in chemical maps that then we correlate and extract information. Here is an example of a sample that is 1.5 millimeters. 1.5 centimeters, 15 millimeters in length, and 5 millimeters in width. And you see this image here is incredibly beautiful. I found it really fascinating, but it looks like, impressionist painting. But the fact is that each of these colors are different elements, so silicon, sulfur, potassium, calcium, magnesium, and so. So if you look at this big image here, maybe I will go back. If we look at this big image here, this inset here is basically zoom of this grain in the top. So basically we have a huge chemical image, and then we can zoom down, and magnify regions of interest with these grains in the last bottom right image. That are really nanoscopic features of the sample. Okay, so this basically allowed us to do things like quantitative mapping of the elements, and then convert these things into something more, useful when it comes to analysis of the data. We just turn these images into ternary diagrams, and these ternary diagrams, of course, are reflecting clearly the composition, and we can basically work on the standard ternary diagrams to analyze these ancient samples, but also to monitor our antiquity, antiqua-inspired samples. So here is the example of antiqua-inspired strategy, and what we did is get inspiration from what Romans used to make things that are in contact with water. And this, for example, most of these materials are reddish, you see, and they are reddish. This is like a bath in Tunisia, bathtub covered with cocio pesto. Cocio pesto is this material that is nothing else than a mortar that contains fragments of ceramics, bricks, that, as I mentioned before, Vitruvius was suggesting to introduce into mixture when the volcanic ash is not available. And they interestingly use these materials always. So cocio pesto was used always in solutions that are related somehow to water effects. So here is an example of Roman aqueduct near Sevilla, and again we do have a opustinium, which is a wall or material that includes cacio-pesto. So cacio-pesto is somehow interesting because, as I said, Romans did it, but I will show you also why we look into it. And we did produce antiqua-inspired samples where we substituted half of our mixture with cacio-pesto of different sizes and lime. And so basically this allowed us to obtain results that are, you know, something not so exotic or not exactly what Romans did, but very close to what we have currently using. But I want to, this is a complex slide, I must say, but let me try to guide you through. So these are results of compressive strength of different mixtures. I want to stress this mixture 5, that is Roman mortar. You see, it's really low after 28 days. That's why Roman mortar is not great when it comes to, you know, applications that we would like to have. You know, we would like to have for current applications, and this antiqua inspired in green spot here mix 6 is 50% OPC, 25% lime, and 25% cacio-pesto. And this one here, you see that shows high, you see the compressive strength, much higher compressive strength after 28 days. Interestingly, it goes to 28.8, around 28 megapascal after 6 months. So we do have an increase of strength. Other data here are mixtures that include also metakaolin. I don't want to focus on this, but you do understand that you know, making different mixtures and adding different components, we can work on these compressive strengths. This increased 33% from first month to 6 months was really an important and interesting aspect that we then looked a little bit better through plotting this as a fraction of OPC strength, and we found that all of our antiqua-inspired samples do show sustained strength gain through different months. You see, month number 1, 2, after 2 months and 6 months, we have a strength activity index that is definitely going up, indicating that there are processes that occur inside different from our ordinary Portland cement. And we try to look into these processes through Raman chemical imaging, and we found out that actually cacio-pesto that is very clear in Raman image, this red grains here, shows always CSH or cache phases around, means that we do have that interesting chemical process of you know, hydrate phases that are always around the cacio-pesto, and this can be the reason why we basically observe that the activity strength activity index going up, because we have a, you know, new component, a new gel phase formed at the interfaces with the cacio-pesto. Why we like cacio-pesto is because of these numbers here. If we substitute, you know, half of our mixture with these antiqua-inspired solutions, we can reduce up to 34% embodied carbon, and we can reduce up to 20% embodied energy of these solutions. Therefore, really an interesting strategy to, you know, solve at the first hand the at least reduced carbon footprint without really thinking and talking about the durability of these materials that we are still testing in the lab. So hopefully these solutions will show resiliency, better resiliency than ordinary portland cement, and therefore perhaps allow our materials to last longer and further improve these numbers. So these are my final remarks, and I told you a little bit about material science and characterization and the capacity now to really work across the scales from molecular, nanoscopic, up to the macroscopic. In this case, macroscopic for me is centimeter big samples, which is quite good when it comes to laboratory settings. And you see, it's important to basically work with these tools in archaeological field, hoping to really reverse engineer some of these aspects through antiqua-inspired materials and design better materials in our civil engineering domain. I would like to conclude this webinar with a beautiful quote from Pedocles, who said in 5th century that before Christ, that the architects should build as if they were to live 1,000 years and live as if they were to die tomorrow. So I think we could learn a lot about our future materials just by looking at this wise suggestion by this philosopher. And I, of course, need to acknowledge my students and the collaborators, the instrumentation development companies, and sites that opened their doors for our work. And thank you for your attention.
Great. Thanks so much, Admir. I really appreciate it and found a lot of interesting topics for discussion here. As a reminder to everyone who's online, we'd love to hear your questions, and there is a Q&A box. And if you have any, please let us know. And it looks like we do indeed have a couple. Let me get started with these. Okay, here's the first question.
Yes.
Do you think we hurt our industry when we talk about buildings lasting only 50 to 100 years? I would think the evidence would suggest a much longer time frame.
Oh, yeah, that's a good point. I mean, when I say that, I must say I refer to what has been documented for Chinese production, Chinese industry. What we guarantee right now, you guys, you will know much better about this. But the best, you know, material that we can guarantee without knowing how long they will last is something like 150 years. Mm-hmm. Please correct me if this is wrong. I'm not aware of companies that can guarantee longer time. And again, I really think that we shouldn't hurt each other, okay? I think we should work together to design better. And when it comes to designing better, I'm talking about materials that for some reason resisted to earthquakes for 2,000 years, okay? There are processes that take place independently from what we have now that are currently available that are responsible for that resiliency. There are processes in these materials that, you know, resist to water effects and degradation and weathering. This is where we should focus our research, and this is where, and again, now that we have tools to look into details of these processes, I think we should aim together to make better products, okay? And this is the, I think, the common objective, independently from carbon footprints, climate change, or whatsoever, independently from that, making good patents on how to make better things is definitely an important, common starting point.
Great. All right, thanks. Here's the next question. We got several coming up. Do slow strength gains, 1 to 6 months of antiquity mixes, require optimum curing conditions?
Oh, yeah, okay. So we do use standard curing conditions, and I must say, again, what we obtained in the lab are results that we try to not reproduce exactly in the sense of Roman technology. So already in the what I want to say is in this graph here, we are already at the level of high strength between the masonry mortar and high strength mortars just by antiquity inspired materials, you know? So this is of course outside, but these are standard processes that we do use in the labs following standards. I don't know if I answered the question. I mean, it's just a standard setting conditions.
Sure. Yeah, I think that's good. Okay, next question. Isn't cacio-pesto in these examples simply a fine aggregate? Would the environmental efficiencies be better compared for concrete rather than cement?
Okay, so we can play with this. Here I showed this slide quickly, but I didn't stress the differences in the granulometry of our materials. Cacio-pesto in a solid red is grains that are smaller than 75 microns, and cacio-pesto that is smaller than 1 millimeter, so they are a little bit bigger grains, is with these white dots dashed. So we need to be careful indeed when it comes to what aggregate or binding media, but when we go down to very small particle size, these reactions that I showed here are more related to perhaps binding, a binder instead of aggregate. These grains here are something like this is 50 microns, so these are like 20 microns, big. Mechanically speaking, of course, could carry some load, but I think we are going down in dimension, therefore more strengthening that binding property instead of aggregate. But we can play both games and define at which level we want to contribute to the mix.
Okay, great. Next question. Can we assume a relatively stable supply of antiqua materials, or will this become a challenge after some time?
The Romans faced that problem with volcanic ash and solved it with cacio-pesto. Theoretically, I must say the problem is there, but in theory, we could think of firing bricks, making them, and the availability of clay, of course, is a question mark. Recycling is kind of cool because we do have a lot of brick around, and I think in this specific application, there is a huge potential. Okay, residues of production that we collect, or we make it, at the at the lower carbon footprint.
Great. Another question is about the Mayan ruins, which were built with limestone and lime and have been around for, you know, over 2,500 years. Have you considered studying these types of materials?
Actually, Mayans are a little bit more recent, but actually there is not much left, I must say. Lime-based chemistry is definitely vulnerable to weathering and environmental effects. I must say again, that chemistry is not so exciting because of the carbonate and vulnerability by definition due to acidic rains and stuff like that. Mayan blue, I mentioned that is really an amazing material, and we are working right now, and there was a huge amount of work put in past two decades to understand Mayan blue, because that pigment, that clay, organic, inorganic composite or compound pigment, is extremely interesting when it comes to durability and properties.
Great, thanks. What do you see in alkali metal ion content? Halides?
I'm not sure how to answer this. It's generally, you know, volcanic ash, aluminum silicates with the ions that are alkali, you know, sodium, potassium.
Okay, great. Any other, you know, maybe I'll, that's the end of the questions we had in the Q&A. You know, maybe I'll just ask one more closing one, but of course, if people have others while I'm asking this, please feel free to add them in. But as you know, we have a lot of people from the cement and concrete industry on the call here. You know, what are some things that you think that the people in industry can actually do to help support this research, or you know, what are some good ways for them to interact specifically on this topic?
Yeah, so I mean, you can see that what I'm dealing with is complex, you know, complex material, and we know how even ordinary Portland cement is complex. But what is really exciting and encouraging me to focus into this research is the capabilities that and capacity that we build when it comes to characterization and modeling of these materials. And I think you know, CSH Hub is a great example of how industry can make impact when it comes to, you know, cutting edge research and developments. And I believe that what we started here in my lab, and I think give us a future outcome is this tight connection with industrial, you know, boundary conditions and research. Fundamental basic research on what is going on, and bringing these two together, perhaps through CSH Hub, is a great opportunity again to explore these specific type of solutions with the aim, of course, to make and optimize current production strategies and the current solutions.
Great. All right. Well, I can't think of any better way to close the webinar than that. So thanks so much, Admir, for taking the time to share this work with us. And if people want to follow up, you can get in touch directly with Admir or also with us at the CS Hub with questions or comments or suggestions. We'd love to engage. So thanks so much, everyone. We recorded this, and we'll be posting it to YouTube in case you missed a few things or if you want to share it with someone who couldn't make it. So, and the details of that will be on our CS Hub website. So,
thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to share my work with you guys.
Our pleasure. Thanks again, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Okay. All right. Bye-bye.